This ComTV special presentation brought to you by Glenn Uhas, Royal LePage Community Realty, Panorama Lanes Family Fun Center, and Danny the Car Guy at City Chrysler.
The reception I've had right across the province has actually blown me away. Who knew Trudeau was so popular in rural Alberta? No, but in all seriousness, from almost 100 people in Vegreville to 200 to 300 people in Bonneville and Pinoca, more than 300 people in Red Deer, crowds in Edmonton and in Calgary. Great reception this morning, about 200 people in Lethbridge, and a packed out crowd here at the Medicine Hat Golf and Country Club. I'm really, really excited about this because people are coming out not because of me or my last name. They're coming out because there's something happening in politics. People are very aware that we are cynical about politics, about the polarization between left and right, about the negativity and the divisions. And we know we deserve better. We know we deserve more. And that's what people want. And that's what I'm so excited about being part of building right now. The Liberal Party has, declined rapidly over the past dozen years. We went from having a majority of 170 seats in 2000 to dropping down to 135 in the next election, to 100 in the election after that, to 77 in the election after that, to 35 in the election after that, and that's a straight line. And it ends up at one seat, because I'm not losing Papineau. But we need to turn that around. But having only 35 seats and being irrelevant right across the country for so many people and so many voters is an opportunity for us to rethink what politics should be about, what politics can be about, and to draw in, once again, Canadians to believe in their political process. Because before we can convince someone that we have the right platform, that we have the right long-term plan and the right vision for this country, we actually have to remind Canadians that politics should be about a long-term vision, a platform, and solutions for this country that will carry us forward through generations. We've forgotten that. We sit on the left and we vote against the right. We sit on the right, we vote against the left. We sit on the west, we vote against the east, east against west, urban against rural. There is a playing up of divisions, of negativity, of differences across the country that doesn't fit with this country. We should do more and better than just accepting the least worst of the options out there. We should do more than voting by brand or by identity. We need to vote with our hearts, with our brains, and mostly with our actions. Because the challenges we're facing do not get solved unless we start to pull together, unless we accept that complex problems don't have simple, easy, soundbite solutions. So we should stop accepting that. We should stop accepting band-aids that'll hold just until the next electoral cycle, as opposed to saying how we build for the next decade or the next generation. These are the challenges we're facing, and this is what I'm so excited about taking on head-on through this leadership campaign. Because this campaign is about not just the Liberal Party reconnecting with Canadians, but Canadians reconnecting with politics in general. The cynicism, the negativity, it just doesn't suit us. It doesn't suit us because we are that one place around the world that has figured out how to be strong, not in spite of our differences, but because of those very differences. From across the country and around the world, people have come to this country and have lived a very similar experience. You get here, it's too big, it's too empty, it's too dang cold, too many months of the year. But we learn that we can work hard, we can succeed, And we do that by leaning on each other and being there for each other. And the fact of the matter is, that success is what has created this country and has allowed us to go beyond our surface differences and understand the shared values that we live by from coast to coast to coast, regardless of our culture or religion or language or origins. We share the values of freedom, of respect, of openness, of compassion, of a drive to work hard, but a willingness to be there for each other when we fall on times of trouble. These are the things that unite us as a country. And the things that unite us are so much stronger than those things which divide us. So the fact that the politics of division have been very effective over the past decade or so is, for me, not just an indication of how clever the dividers are and how smart Karl Rove was in the United States to figure out a way to move money and micro-target and wedge issues to get people elected. It's about the fact that something's happening here in Canada. We have a country that was based around a simple premise, a simple promise, that you could come here and you could work hard, and you could create success not just for yourself, which meant security and stability and prosperity, but you would create with your hard work greater opportunities for the next generation. And every generation in this country has told that story. Every generation created more opportunities for the next. Until now. We right now have a generation that is worried, and the numbers back this up, that our children and our grandchildren will not have greater opportunities than we had, will not have a better quality of life than we had. And that's extremely unsettling and destabilizing. And when we as human beings are feeling uncertain, it's always easiest to point fingers. It's their fault. It's his fault. It's her fault. It's us versus them. And that's exactly what our politics should be countering. We need to be better than that. We need to go beyond that. We need to make sure and understand that the prosperity of this country is based on having a strong, stable, secure, thriving middle class. And we haven't done that. It's the story I've heard right across the country over the past years. People just finding it harder than before to get by. And there's all sorts of different ways of defining what a strong economy is. But a strong economy, what it really is in real terms, is having the largest number of people with the best possible jobs. That's what creates a strong economy. And the numbers bear it out that we're not doing well, because over the past 30 years, the Canadian economy has more than doubled in size. We've grown more than 100%. But your average middle class incomes have increased by only 13%. The largest number of people who work hardest to create the prosperity in this country are not sharing in the benefits of what we're creating. And that has to change. That has to change for economic reasons, because that's what makes us successful. But it also has to change for reasons of what creates this very country. That promise of upward mobility, of success, of a path for our most vulnerable to find good jobs and succeed with the resources and the help that they need to get, of a strong, robust market for our businesses, for our small businesses, for our big businesses, to be able to, you know, offer services to a confident and prosperous middle class. That's what creates a strong country. But more than that, that's what allows us to go beyond the easy divisions of, well, he looks different, or she has an accent, or they're from a different club, or a different religion, or a different part of the world. That's what's made us successful in this country. And that's what we have to get back to. So the Liberal Party is taking this opportunity, since we're in free fall, to realize that we can do things now that we couldn't do if we still had 100 seats in the House. We can turn it right around. We can turn to Canadians and say, we need your help. Canada needs your help. Those supporter sheets on your tables. If you sign up, you're not saying
you're a Liberal.
Because, you know, I mean, I know there are a handful of Liberals here, and I really appreciate it. So it's great that you have such a strong Liberal presence in Medicine Hat. Well, we have a strong presence in Medicine Hat, and the rest will remain to see. But what we need is people, and you all, just by being here today, have demonstrated that, you know, there is a possibility that sometime in the future it might occur to you maybe to perhaps vote for the Liberal Party one day. You know what? In Southern Alberta, that's good enough for us. And that openness is absolutely essential, because it shows we're willing to trust not just Liberals, but Canadians. For the first time ever, a federal party has said no membership fees, no proof that you're a Liberal and always have been. We're turning to Canadians and say, help us get it right. Perhaps we haven't made the best choices in the past years in terms of our leadership. We need to make sure we get this one right. So can you help us? Can you sign up and help us with your vote come April to make sure that we set this party in the right direction? Because this country is not a country that's ideologically bound to the left or to the right. And both the Conservatives and the NDP would love nothing more than to see the middle option disappear, so that people have no choice but to vote for or against. People have no choice but to be polarized. And when we see what happens in the United States with the stasis, with the challenges, we need a party that is pragmatic, that is value-based, that is willing to draw on best evidence and best practices, and mostly refuses to play up one part of the country against the other. That's what we're seeing. Mr. Harper is firmly ensconced in the West. Mr. Mulcair is picking votes in the East by attacking the West and its success. We need a political party that's willing to stand forward and say, let's work together. And I think one of the things that I've seen that underlines the crowds that have come out for me and for the Liberal Party across Alberta is that here, where the reform movement was born, this idea that the undemocratic, unaccountable, secretive, top-down government of Brian Mulroney in the late 80s needed to be turned towards a level of grassroots engagement, respect for individuals, service to your community, and making the voices of this part of the world resonate strongly in the halls of power, has turned into that which it wanted to replace. We have never had as secretive and as top-down a government as we have right now. And unfortunately, the members of Parliament that are elected here in Alberta tend to mostly be spokespeople for the government in their ridings, as opposed to spokespeople for their ridings to government. And everyone deserves better than that, particularly Albertans. So that's why I'm asking for your help. I'm asking for your support, but mostly I'm asking for each one of you to expect and demand more. To demand more from your leaders and your representatives, to demand more from your neighbors and your community, but mostly to demand more from yourselves. How you engage, how you become activists and citizens to create a better community through your actions on the ground, which you do very much in strong community centers and community organizations, but also through your political voices, through your choices, through your expectations. We need to start getting re-engaged with the politics of this country, because this cynicism isn't giving us the tools to address with the kind of confidence and strength that Canadians have always been able to surmount challenges and obstacles of the past. So thank you for coming out here today. Thank you for your support. Merci beaucoup. Sit down. We now get to the fun part. We get to the fun part where you guys get to ask me questions. Part of what I've done across the country has been engaging with and listening to people in different communities right across the country, so I get a better sense of what's preoccupying you, and so you get a better sense of what politics is supposed to be, which is supposed to be a conversation, a challenge, back and forth, in which you are participants, not just objects of propaganda and a sales job to try and earn your votes. This is much more about this. We need your involvement. Yes, dear.
Okay, I have a question for you. I've been reading in the Maclean's magazine how the university students are having a hard time finding a job in their field of choice because there are no jobs there. So my question is, if you are so lucky to become the leader of our party, how would you get around to seeing that the university people can get jobs in our field?
That's a great question, and my role within the Liberal Party has for the past years been around post-secondary education. So a question about how our university graduates are going to be able to find employment and contribute to our society, which was the question, is an important one to me. We have to understand there is a perception out there that university graduates are having an awfully hard time finding jobs. And yes, during recession times and during difficult times like this, it takes them a little longer to find jobs. But in general, we're doing pretty well on that. The challenge is there are too many people not being able to access post-secondary education. And when studies across the country have shown that perhaps 70% of all jobs in the future are going to require post-secondary education of some sort, we have to make sure that maybe 70% of our citizens have access to post-secondary education. But it's not just about access, it's access to quality post-secondary education. That means making sure that we're not allowing class sizes to explode or selling off our universities to private companies because they have money that they want to invest in. We have to make sure that there's always a balance and that we build properly the capacity that we have. Access to education means, yes, financial access up front in terms of help with tuition fees for some, but on the back end, help with student debts for others. It means access is also about the path to education. Are we having quality high school? Are we having quality primary school? Certainly, in far too many First Nations communities across the country, education is not being given the kind of investment and the tools it needs to succeed. We need to start looking at how we build a knowledge economy, understanding that, yes, we will always draw on and be wealthy because of our natural resources, but we need to get the best out of our natural resources, and in order to do that, we have to invest in our human resources, which is our most important resource in this country. So thank you very much for that question. Another question. Yes?
I asked you an understatement, and there's a lot of misconceptions as to that we get a lot of money. I've heard a lot of stuff. How would you bridge
Thank you very much for your question. The question was about relations with First Nations people and how we start to bridge the success gap, the quality of life gap, how we draw on the success and the potential of Aboriginal Canadians to participate fully in the country that we have. Now, if you talk to a number of politicians, they'll either say directly or they'll suggest that this Idle No More movement represents a real problem. For me, it represents a tremendous opportunity. We have a generation of grassroots Aboriginal activists, many of them young, most of them young, who are saying, you know what? Enough. We have to be part of the conversations. We have to be part of building the success. And while I understand there are very powerful moral and value-based arguments for us to get it right, and we have to be very serious about it because of the tremendous damage Canada did to Aboriginal communities over the decades and centuries through assimilationist policies and residential schools. The most compelling reason is not about atoning for the past, although that's important. It's about how we're building for the future. Aboriginal communities across this country have almost 50% of their members under the age of 25. This is not just the future of those communities, this is the future of the country we have to get right with our aging population. And as we start shifting our thinking about how we define success in our economy and our country, we have to understand that, and we're all talking about it, we're moving towards a balance between economic prosperity and long-term environmental sustainability, that we can't have something that is short-term beneficial if it's going to come at a cost in the long term. We're understanding that within our society, that need for openness and balance. Well, that's something that has been modeled in the values and the philosophies of Aboriginal First Nations peoples across this country for millennia. And we need to draw on their successes to be part of our successes. We need to learn from these people that we've tried to marginalize successfully for too long. So we have an awful lot of work to do. It's about building a partnership. It's about starting a relationship that's based on respect and shared values and mutually achieved goals. And the politics of setting up divisions and leaking reports to set public opinion against First Nations people, the politics of trying to divide the chiefs among themselves for short-term political gain is unconscionable, because the challenge of leadership is not to win an argument or a contest. It's about serving. It's about taking the energy that is being generated across this country by strong Aboriginal voices and channeling that into positive outcomes. And the big message that comes out of it for me is one of my favorite First Nations sayings, which is that we do not inherit the earth from our parents, we borrow it from our grandchildren. And the more we think like that, the more we understand the work ahead of us that we have to do all together, the better off we're all going to be. Merci beaucoup tout le monde. Thank you very, very much. It was a pleasure to meet with you all. We have sign-up forms on all the tables. If you have any questions for me or you want to sign up online, come check out my website at justin.ca. Yes, I'm the Justin in Canada. And I look forward to continuing to work with people across this country to build a better and brighter future for us all. Merci beaucoup tout le monde. I have to go to the back and do a quick media hit. I was glad to be able to have a chance to chat with so many of you in the line for food, and I look forward to the next time I'm back in the hat. Thank you.
I was telling Justin when he first arrived, the last time I saw him, he was about 20 inches long, being pushed in a carriage at 24 Sussex. That was my first job in your city, but he's come a long way, and we're really proud of what he's done.
I had extraordinary role models around me.
Yeah, super. No, I'm just so pleased that you had a chance to make it here. I mean, a few leaders have made it through. It seems like they made it without any fanfare. And I know that's not what you want. You need support, and we're here to try to support you. And that's the main thing. So we're really thankful that Daryl included us, for one thing, in the tour, and that you accepted it. Medicine Hat is still, and it's good for our party also here. It's good to build, because the media coverage on this has already been good. We had to limit the number of tickets. There's just a lot of people wanted to come, so please understand this. So to recognize your trip and visit here, we have a little blanket to give you. It's actually a blanket of Medicine Hat.
Want to
open it up?
Oh, wow.
It depicts a little bit of what Medicine Hat is all about. So I know when you travel, maybe late at night, when you're going back home, or maybe when the kids are in the back seat, it opens it up the other way.
How beautiful. Here we go. This way. Thank you.
This is a good indication of exactly what Medicine Hat stands for and the community that was built here over the years, from railway to gas to, we name it, for clay, for the farming and ranching around here. So anyway, we thank you very much for making your stop, and good luck.
Thank you, Mayor Boucher. Merci. Thank you. Thank you all.